This video is going to be about as pointless as it gets, because I'm going to attempt to just list out some of the things that I've lost as far as the music studio goes. Sun's going down. I'm still ready to pass out. I was able to make a closing argument video after I had my 4 ounces of food, so at least that one I wasn't totally exhausted. Back at the end of July, I had made a PDF showing the items that I had lost to that point. I did that for a couple of resources that I sent that to. And one of the things I mentioned was, you know, for a long time I've lobbied. I wouldn't say this is something I put a lot of effort into, but if the opportunity arises, I have certainly voiced my, picked up the phone more than once on this one and told legislators that there should be stronger punishments for people who steal certain musical instruments. Now, my main instruments are drums and guitar. I haven't had a drum set. I moved here with one, but I sold it because there's no music scene here. There's nothing you can do with it here. And the traffic's harder to drive in than it was in Los Angeles. So, if I had that drum set and somebody stole it, I would be really bummed, but it's replaceable. You can just pretty much buy any drum set and tune it, and there you're back up and running. I would miss it, yeah, but it's okay. Now, there might be a certain drum set that has more sentimental value. Of course, that's a different story. If I played trombone or trumpet or oboe or clarinet or flute, it's kind of the same thing. I mean, yes, you get used to your instrument, but if it got stolen, unless there's some special circumstance to it, you know, it was handed down from your great-grandmother or something, you can buy another one and get back into it. You don't really lose a lot playing another of the same instrument. But when it comes to certain instruments, I would say the ones that are the most expressive, and that would be stringed instruments, including piano, guitar, violin, cello, things of that nature, versus, say, harmonica. A guitar, a cello, I mean, they're almost shaped like a body, you know, they have the headstock, they call it a headstock, it has a neck, and then it has a body. It has a very human form, but it is so expressive. You can bend the strings, you can slide, you can trill, you can do all manner of things with it. And the instrument itself has so much to do with the sound and the tone and the playability. The type of wood, the amount of clear coat on it, you know, just all the things about the instrument. So, you know, so there have been many times when I've talked to legislators about something else, or I've just picked up the phone and said, I'm going to call a few and voice this. Certain instruments, like guitars, they should really treat it more like a kidnapping, or like someone stealing your pet. That's probably a better example. The fact that American Musical Supply, a music store, cost me all of my instruments, including more guitars than I dare to count right now, is just disgusting in ways that you can't even speak about it. It's just unspeakably disgusting. I have a note here, the owner of one of the local music stores here in Minneapolis area, they actually came out and said to me that it should be equivalent to kidnapping if someone steals a guitar. So I'm not the only person who feels that way. thanks to American Musical Supply, a music store, I've lost all of mine, except for the ones that I can't sell, and I'm just going to lose them with storage. Can't sell them because they have problems with them, and that's why I bought them cheap, and I was going to fix them. What they did is disgusting, and to give you an even better sense of how sickening this is, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I'm going to show you the first 8 guitars that I lost, and there were many more after that, because they were in this list. The reason I'm going to show them to you is because all my guitars had names. That's how special they are. I didn't name my drum set. I didn't name my drums. Before I do that, I've said this before, in storage there's hundreds of things. When I went through my cabinets, there's all these CDs in there. And some of them, like the box set for the Zombies, or the box set for the Yardbirds, the complete Yardbirds collection. The 50th anniversary Odyssey and Oracle from the Zombies, things like this. I mean, one of the things I lost was my vinyl of the original Rush album, the 200 gram vinyl, unopened. I've been holding on to that thing. I don't even remember how many years I've been holding on to that. And I had to let it go for probably less than I paid for it. Those things are selling for hundreds of dollars online, but I can't sell things online in my situation. When I went through that cabinet, you had that, but also you had all these just little things. Maracas and shakers. Maracas, egg shakers, picks, car fuses, switches, strings, tubes, hardware for guitars, $20 amplifiers, a recorder, pedals, a monster, books, training books, chord books, my tape-driven camcorder from 20 years ago, Panasonic, straps, trays, tools, guitar repair and maintenance, refinishing tools, regular tools, power tools, cables out the wazoo, a bottle of wine. USB hubs. Documents. Screws and hardware for guitars. Snow shovel. Home decor. Small 5-watt tube amp, 2 of them for stereo. Drum mat. Tie rack. Bags. Rowland shoes. Laptop stand, LTS-50 from Samsung. That beautiful Fender amplifier. Foot switches, 1, 2. Behind there is a graphics high precision mouse, corded. Boss Katana Mini. Another old laptop. Kettle. Piedmont Junior Hohner harmonica collection, all the different keys in one case. I have a mandolin. I have ukulele. I have a guitalele. I have a Merlin dulcimer. I just have one of all these different things, and they took me 18 years to accumulate here. And I'm losing all of it. And when you go through those cabinets, there's just everywhere you look, there is something, and I can remember the story in most cases of where I got this or why I got this. That when I talked about layers of trauma in a previous video, it wasn't even the tip of the iceberg. And when you have to carry this stuff that is so special to you that you never should have lost, only because hateful people destroyed you did you lose it. And you have to go carry it into a pawn shop over and over and over again. Carry both arms, carrying as much as you can, sometimes having to take two trips. Being as dirty and smelling as bad as I do, everyone in there assumes that I'm a drug addict selling my stuff to get my next hit, when it's probably a drug addict who is responsible for all of this. It's disgusting. The layers of trauma and injustice never, ever end. And then after you go into a pawn shop with a bunch of stuff repeatedly, they learn that you're desperate and they start lowballing you. And I can't tell you how many of these things, because what I bought were super special instruments and gear. That black Elvis microphone, limited edition, that was out for like 3 months, right at the beginning of when I started working at American Musical Supply. So many of these things, when I take them into a pawn shop or guitar center or something, all the employees, they ignore me altogether and they just swarm around the thing I'm selling, and they're all like, oh my god, I gotta get that, that is so cool, that's the most beautiful guitar I've ever seen. A black S Super 55. Oh my gosh, I didn't even know they made those. That's incredible. I gotta get this. And I'm just watching all these guys drool over my stuff. One guy at Guitar Center, for the three synthesizers I had that I've lost now, all three of them, when I brought it in there, he puts on headphones and starts testing it. And he just starts playing the thing, going through everything and just playing it for like 10, 15 minutes. The last time, I had to go over there and try to respectfully ask him to help me, quit playing with my instruments and help me. The stuff I had was so good and so rare. Nobody had ever seen a Korg Micro X before. I can't even find them online. There's a couple black ones, not a white one. They're all lost. But when it comes to these guitars, I give them names. So what I did was I put them on there, if possible, showing what the current price is if they're still sold. Now things like my USA-made Gibson that I bought when I first started working there, they stopped selling them a few years ago, and I wouldn't want another one. I want the one that I took care of for 7 years, like a baby. I went in there frequently and pulled all that stuff out and went and got it, took it out, made sure it's humidified, played it. Got it up to tuning, make sure everything's great with it, make sure the humidifiers are in there, and put her back. So the Gibson guitar, which was a Les Paul tribute, natural wood. None of that thick clear coat that most Gibsons have. That one was named Jenny. That's after a very dear high school friend I had back in the mid-80s. The Squire Starcaster. Squire is a sub-brand of Fender. So it's basically a Fender Starcaster that I showed previously when I got the hotel. I sold that. That walnut finish is so rare. I named that one Sandy after a good friend from Drum and Bugle Corps. The Taylor GS Mini that I worked so hard for, I went through that whole training process. I don't know how long it took, a month, couple months, to get that free GS Mini. And I just named that one Bob, after the founder of Taylor Guitars, Bob Taylor. Last time I went into the pawn shop to sell the most recent thing, that guitar was hanging right there. In fact, when I go into these pawn shops, especially in the guitar area, I can't even go inside these places. If I look in the guitar area, the whole area are my guitars hanging on the wall. And if I went and looked at their gear, I'd find all my recorders and my synthesizers and everything else. My Washburn Billy T, again with that pickup configuration, I've never seen one like it before. I named it Billy because the guitar is called a Billy T, but that was also a friend of mine in graduate school. The Squire M80 guitar, which was basically a limited edition signature model from one of Fender's, you know, high-end luthiers, I named that one Lisa, after another friend from Jung and Bugle Corps. The PV Patriot fretless bass guitar, which I've never seen one before. This thing might have been a prototype. I checked it. I converted a guitar into fretless before. I've looked at it carefully. I don't see where it was a conversion. I could be wrong. I think this was a prototype. I named it Geddy, after Geddy Lee from Rush. Favorite bass player. I'll never get that guitar again. It was one of a kind. My vintage V72 Thinline Telecaster. This is the definition of a country guitar. That beautiful Proloid pickguard. I named it Nancy after a cowgirl who I probably should have married from church back in the 80s. She was after me, but she was older than me, and everybody around us said, oh, she can't have anything to do with him. She's too old for him. How stupid is that? For the next 40 years, it wouldn't have mattered. And my Schecter C7 guitar, the only 7-string guitar I have ever enjoyed playing. Ever. This Diamond Series, this particular finish, this natural finish, I just don't see it very often. I mean, I never see it. You'd have to go online to find it. That thing played like a dream for a 7-string guitar. I named that one Marla, after someone else I knew back in graduate school and who was a really good friend back then. With no family and no friends in Minnesota nice, and I'm working all the time, and when I'm not working, I'm working on some project. The town's not set up for getting around. It just isn't a place where, and besides, I worked with so many people I cared about. I got to spend all day with them. Fine, that was great. Now I can go do my own thing. These instruments, should not have lost any of them. I did nothing that would justify losing my job and losing all of those things and losing everything. I did nothing wrong. As you're soon gonna see. So all I can do at this point is see how many pictures I can put on here behind a song of the things I lost, the things that I spent 18 years shopping for, some of those things I would spend, jeez. If there's something I actually wanted, sometimes it took months and months and months to find it. Maybe more than a year. The time investment on that. For me to do that again, I would be almost 80 years old when I'm done. If I replicated what I did to acquire that stuff. This is permanent. This is the point I'm trying to make. What American Musical Supply did to me is permanent. As if death isn't permanent enough. Their obliteration of my life is permanent. It can't be resurrected. I can't go back and do 18 years worth of searching for all these things. And I wouldn't want to that quickly. Part of the fun of it, part of the charm of it, was doing that searching every week after week after week for year after year after year after year. It was part of my routine. It was my way of relaxing, my way of blowing off steam after work. It was integrated in my life and who I am and what my life was. And to have all of it stolen from me, especially these instruments that I personally feel people should be charged with kidnapping if they steal these things, or at least dog napping. My employer of 7 years, a music store, American Musical Supply, effectively stole all of that from me because there was no reason I should have been fired. And people keep giving their money to this music store to make that owner, if he even really exists, to make him richer than Solomon. I have so many videos when I went into storage and filmed what was in there, and all these little, all these things here and there, the complete Beatles guitar sheet music, the complete Led Zeppelin guitar sheet music, just all these little amplifiers I bought. I mean, I'd often get them for $20 to $50 a piece, and I would always buy two so that I had them in stereo, because I love stereo effects. This is an incomprehensible loss. And I don't want to think about it, so I don't know how many pictures I'm going to put in this video, but it's only 1/1000th of what I'm losing. And don't make an assumption that a big synthesizer or a big guitar is more important than one of those puppets. Don't think that. Everything was important to me. If you took everything I had and put it in an apartment, there's a lot of empty space. I don't have that much stuff. I only had things that mattered to me. And everything that matters to me was taken away by American Musical Supply. I don't know if I even have it in me to do the transition I was going to do into the song. Think I walk out in the rain.